Welcome to the Real Film Nerds Podcast.
Welcome, welcome, welcome everybody back to kind of another episode of the Real Film Nerds Podcast, I guess. This is what they call a swapcast. I recently got a chance to sit down at one of the local downtown Prescott watering holes, the Raven Café, with Mr. Mile High Show, Matt Santos, and fellow local Prescott podcaster who is braver than both of us, who does a video podcast with a couple other hardcore Star Wars nerds. That's Mr. Dirk VandenBerg from the Bluemilk podcast. And we talked about summer blockbuster movies, mostly about the movies that impacted our individual lives. We also talked a little bit about the movie theaters that we went to. Mr. Mahaisho, you know, always talks about growing up in the San Francisco Bay Area and some of the incredible movie theaters that he got to go to back then. Dirk talks about going to the Cine Capri down in Phoenix. He grew up down in Phoenix, and we all reminisce about the good old days of the drive-in movie theater. And then I also discuss attending one of the places I spent a lot of my time growing up as a child, especially in the summer, and that is Mysterious Mike and I's, I don't want to say like giant movie theater, just cinema, I guess. It was three screens, small little place, but I'd reminisce about that because I spent a lot of hours there. It is no longer there. I think it's a church or something now. So I talk about that. We have quite a few beers at the Raven Cafe. I got a chance to meet their newest manager. Her name is Alexis. Very sweet lady. Definitely make sure to pop in, say hello, tell you heard about the Raven on the Mile High Show or the Real Film Nerds Podcast. She would be giddy about that. So enough of me ranting and raving because this is a long one. It felt like we talked all night and drank all night, but it was a blast. I had a great time, and I hope you enjoy listening to the three of us chat it up about summer blockbuster movies and just movies in general. Don't forget to tell your friends about the Real Film Nerds Podcast. Don't forget to like, subscribe, share all three of our podcasts. Try and support the local podcasting scene. We're trying to do nothing but grow and get bigger and better and have more guests on and do more material and see more movies. Let us know how we're doing, all of us. Email all of us. Visit all our websites, you know? MileHighShow.com, TheBlueMilkPodcast.com, RealFilmNerds.com. It's all similar across all the different social medias, except for the Blue Milk Podcast. I believe you can find them on YouPorn. I'm not sure why they decided to do that, but tear it up, man. More power to you. Get as many viewers as you can. So enough of my ranting and raving. Enjoy Real Film Nerds Podcast 113 / Mile High Show Podcast 207. And Mike and I will be back next week to chat with you about James Gunn's latest horror superhero movie, Brightburn. Until next week, everybody, go out and catch a movie.
Well, thanks for tuning in. This is Matt Santos of the Mile High Show. You're listening to a podcast. You're listening to number 207. We are recording here at the Raven Cafe in Prescott, Arizona on Cortez Street. Check them out at the link below because I don't remember anything. Hey, what's your website?
RavenCafe.com.
RavenCafe.com and the Raven Cafe on Facebook. Hey, hey, we're a professional outfit here. Leave us alone. We are hanging out here. We being from the Real Film Nerds Podcast, Mr. Matt Henshaw, and Dirk the Drinker from the Blue Milk Podcast. We're sitting down. We're going to get into some memories of movies and summer blockbusters, because we're about to break into the summer season and summer vacation. So stick around, listening on that. We're going to have a good time. I'm guessing we are. Usually I record these after the podcast. This one I'm doing beforehand. So I'm just assuming, I'm predicting that we had a lot of fun doing this. Check out our Amazon link at milehighshow.com for all your online shopping. It's a way to support the show and make sure I can pay this bar tab when we're done. What else is going on? The third Thursday of every month right here at the Raven is the Raven Spectacular. It is happening, well, it's happening tomorrow, the day we're recording this, but about 5 days ago when this actually comes out. So I will predict I had a fairly decent set. It's an open mic, that Raven Spectacular, every third Thursday at 7 p.m. at the Raven Café. It's a lot of fun, a good mixture of musicians, poetry, storytelling, and a few of us idiots up there telling a joke or two. So check them out. Again, links are at the Raven Café website, Raven's Facebook page, and right there at the Mile High Show Facebook page as well. So thanks for tuning in. Sit back and enjoy our conversation with Dirk VandenBerg of the Bluemilk Podcast, Mr. Matt Hinshaw of the Real Film Nerds Podcast, and me, the host of the Mile High Show, for episode 207, recorded right here at the Raven Cafe in Prescott, Arizona. Now, Matt, you brought notes.
Yeah, well, that's because I am of the Real Film Nerds Podcast, and I like dates, and I like times, and I like lists.
Well, so and I know, let's clarify. Let's clarify. When he says he likes dates, he's either talking about dried fruit or marks on the calendar, because he ain't getting any other kind of dates out there.
I was kind of thinking the
same
thing.
I do live in Prescott, Arizona, where I've dated all three women under the age of 65 here.
You kidding, man? You kidding? This place is filled with beautiful women. Right here in the bar, actually. There's a couple. There's one right behind you. She's sitting with her husband, I think.
And they're getting prettier all the time.
They're getting prettier all the time.
I'm sure he'll be.
Dirk, I'm going to steal a page right out of the Bluemilk Podcast. Excuse me, the Real Film Nerds Podcast. Dirk, what are you drinking?
I think she said it was an Alaskan Amber. And
oddly enough, also the name of the girl sitting behind Hinshaw.
I think so. Yeah.
But the question is that the stripper name or?
Oh, of course.
Okay, so that's a professional name.
How's it taste?
Alaskan Amber.
Yeah.
It's a good beer. It's a very common beer. It's just you come to a place like this, you want to get something a little bit more risque.
And I did. I wanted to, but they didn't have it.
Which one are you looking at?
Something else.
Oh, okay. I was gonna say, the 180 shilling isn't bad, but it's the little 10 ounce.
What are you drinking, Matty?
I don't know. Whatever you're drinking, some kind of fruity cider thing.
It's crazy sweet. It's a shilling Emerald City Blackberry Pear Cider, because I am a firm believer of getting your fair servings of fruits and vegetables every day.
Well done.
Makes two of us.
Bloody Marys, tomato juice. It's both a fruit and a vegetable, I think. I don't know. You're the scientist.
It's a fruitstable.
Fruitstable? Okay, Ronald Reagan. Ketchup. It's a vegetable.
Know. You know, this time I really don't care what it is.
Yeah. All right, give the plugs. Let's get those out of the way. MileHighShow.com, links to all the social media and all that good stuff. And that Amazon link. Don't forget. Use that Amazon link so I can pay this bar tab. Matty, give all your plugs.
No, dude, nobody listens anyways. It's fine.
Well, do your podcast. They
exactly.
Listen to mine.
They listen to yours, so they don't need to know about mine. So, Dirk, go ahead.
Matt, come on. Come out.
Come on. No, seriously, nobody listens. It's realfilmnerds.com, at realfilmnerds everywhere. If you want photos not shot by the other Matt, it's at Hinshaw Photo. But as I was relating to your Facebook post today from the Hitapixel website, the news photo website.
Yeah.
Did you watch that video? That was so depressing.
Oh, of the working for free, yeah.
And
yeah, I did.
It takes them posting something like that for people to know. You and I have been dealing with that especially locally here, for 10 years.
People post things like that all the time, and then it gets people all riled up for a week, and then they forget. And then those same people that, which oddly enough, when I post these, what it is it's a photographer venting on the fact that people work for free. And I have had people, I've posted those before, similar posts and similar videos, and people will comment on them and say, that's ridiculous, you're an artist. Those same people 2 weeks later are calling me to do some stuff for free. So
it's nice.
So don't do things for free. Go to milehighshow.com, use that Amazon link, and help me pay this bar tab. Okay, Dirk, where can folks find out about you and your cohorts on that Filthy Mouth podcast you do?
Filthy Mouth. It's accurate.
Remember, this one is not.
The Bluemilk podcast.com takes you to our YouTube page where we have all of our videos, all of our episodes. Facebook.com. Also, look up the Bluemilk podcast, and we have exclusive content there. We're also on Twitter and various other.
Now, you guys are fancy. You do podcast. No, you are. You do a video podcast.
We are video.
Because for anybody that knows me specifically or Matt Hinshaw, there's a reason we are behind the camera most of our lives.
Well,
I do not want to be on video.
Some of us should be just on radio.
Now you guys aren't doing an audio separate stream, right? It's strictly
not yet,
video?
No.
Strictly YouTube?
It's been thrown around, but we haven't taken that step
but
yet.
You guys get, I'm not joking, you guys get fancy. You have intros, you have graphics. You have some giggling boy drinking ciders in the corner. What's his name? Who's on your show with you?
There Jacob? Is Jacob Sparks and BJ. Lordy.
BJ
Lordy. I almost forgot his name.
I love BJ. Well, specifically, I love his mom, and not in a weird way. She pays me. She cuts me my check. She is the finance clerk. No, she's a finance clerk for one of my clients.
That is a little creepy, yeah.
No.
She pays him now.
she works in the finance department for one of my clients, so every month I send BJ's mommy my invoice, and she deposits money in my account. We love you, Kat.
Does she put little X's and O's on it, too?
No, I don't believe she knows my name. She knows my wife more than she knows me. I don't care as long as that money hits my account each and every month by the 5th.
Fair enough.
Okay, so you got BJ, Lordy, you got Jacob Sparks, and yourself, and you guys get visited periodically. Oh, I'm sorry. You get visited periodically with your significant other.
Every once in a while, yeah.
What is her
name? We just name call for her the woman.
The woman?
Yes, yes. And that's what I call her off camera as well.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong, you take care of kind of the graphic stuff and the production value of the Bluemilk podcast?
Yeah.
Kind
of? I handle the animation. I handle editing, credits, what I call cooking the episodes, getting them all prepped and ready to go up on YouTube. So I'm more the technical side of things.
Now, Maddie's Real Film Nerds is a dissection with his secret agent in hiding, Mike Talent. They discuss movies both new and what do you call the
you could just say my hetero life mate.
What's the term you guys use? I forget. Legacy.
Okay, I do Legacy
if it's
podcast. Not currently in the theaters.
Yeah.
If it's on a streaming service, it is known as a tributary.
Yeah.
So it's not Netflix and chill. It's tributary because it's streaming. So
you guys cover all kinds of subjects, all kinds of movies. What episode are you up to now?
Well, 111 was yesterday. We've had to cut back because Mike has a real life. And he's married, and he's trying to create more life, and his wife likes doing stuff with him, I guess. It's really weird.
Probably the whole creating life thing.
Yeah, it's both of that. It's a lot of that. But so he doesn't have time anymore.
Yeah.
It kind of sucks. So we did 111. We're doing one a week now instead of two a week. Where 111 came out yesterday, and it was about the new, dramatization of Ted Bundy.
Yeah.
Starring Zac Efron. It was an interesting Netflix film.
Now, Dirk, you guys, Bluemilk Podcast, For those of you in the know, I had to ask. I had to Google it when I first met you, a year and a half ago, whenever it was.
Yeah, about
Star Wars is?
No, what Bluemilk was. I've watched them. I've had great naps. But yours is Star Wars centric, right?
Yes.
That's what you guys are doing?
Yes, anything and everything Star Wars related.
Well, that leads into why I wanted to sit down with you two guys specifically. One, because it was an excuse to get out to the Raven. But also because as we're coming into now, like I said, we're recording this on one day. It'll be out in about a week or so. We're coming into summer break, summer vacation for school. My little guy, he's going to be coming out of third grade, getting ready for fourth. And one of the big things when I was growing, I'm the oldest one at this table, but when I was growing up.
You can't be more than 90.
No, right, 89 and a half. What is that in months? You're the scientist.
I'm not calculating anything right now.
But when I was younger and when we were growing up, when all of us were growing up, because it hasn't changed until...
I still have not grown up.
Fairly recently when we were younger.
I can vouch for that.
Yeah. The summer blockbusters were huge, and also the holiday blockbusters. There were release times for movies.
Yep.
There were times... even on TV, when movies would play the same time every year.
Oh, yeah, we'd wait for them.
Yeah, pre-cable, pre-streaming, obviously. For me, anyway, pre-DVD.
We had 13 TV channels.
Yeah.
And we waited every year for Twilight Zone type thing.
All of that has changed. We want to talk about how... we consume movies has changed. How we look forward to movies. There's still those ones, those marquee ones, like Star Wars, like the superhero, like the Marvel Universe movies that are big releases still. But it was before, it was the major movies. That's how they were released. So we want to talk a little bit about that. Talk about how we consume movies, how we consume content now, how that's changed over the years. But right now, a little background, because, Dirk, you've sat with us. We've talked before, but let's refresh the listener, a little bit of your background. Now, I was joking. I'm 53. What are you, Maddie?
I don't know.
37? Dirk, where
I'm
do you fall?
43.
43. So I got 37, 10.
37, really?
Yeah. You
I swore
this,
you're older than
like
me, man.
120 or
you
something.
Are.
Well,
you
he
lived a hard life.
He hasn't right? lived right, and you know it. Dirk, okay, so 43, born in 76, 75,
correct.
76. What are your memories of first movies that you were seeing at the theater? What some of the ones that stick in your head?
And we have discussed this before. The first movie I can remember ever seeing is the original Star Wars.
Yeah.
I was a year old.
And you remember that?
I remember it. I remember the ending specifically,
yeah.
But I remember we were at a drive-in. I remember the music. I remember my parents. It's a very solid memory.
Wow, cool.
I love it.
Now, for when I was growing up, obviously, you know, as a young kid, back up a little bit. My mom, when she grew up in the 30s, they went to the movies all the time. They lived near a theater. It was walking distance every Saturday. They would get a nickel, be able to get in the movie, buy a treat, a snack, a candy, or popcorn, whatever, and spend all day in the movies. That was the kiddie matinee things.
Yep.
They would go in and watch cartoons, watch a couple of B-roll movies, watch some the major one, then some serials. They would be. She has beautiful stories that we grew up listening to about when her and all her brothers and sisters and the kids from the neighborhood would go to the theater, the Bow Theater in San Leandro, California.
The
Bow,
B-A-L. Oh, okay.
And a big right. movie house, and they would spend all Saturday watching movies, and that's what they did. And then they'd go home and act them out. It was a big thing. So growing up, I'm the youngest of six kids. We grew up with my mom's love of movies, so we watched old movies on TV and stuff. But as a youngster, you know, obviously the Disney movies, the Herbie the Love Bugs, things like that.
Right.
Swiss Family Robinson, the kiddie movies and cartoon movies we would watch. The first movie that wasn't a kid movie, and I don't like using the word adult movie because obviously it wasn't an adult movie, but the first non-kid movie.
Wrong podcast yeah, right. for that.
The first kid movie, non-kid movie that I saw in the theater was Fiddler on the Roof. And I believe it was a re-release, because they used to do that, too.
Yes.
They would release something. A few years later, it would come out, because there was no cable. There was no HBO, nothing like that.
Right.
So they would re-release it, get some money. You know, the studios would get another payday. And I remember going to see that as a family. My uncle and some cousins went with us. We went as a group to see it. And to this day, because of that, Fiddler on the Roof is one of my favorite movies of all time.
It's a good one.
Because stuck in my head is seeing this for the first time on the big screen and just falling in love with it. I am not a big Star Wars fan, as have been discussed on this many of times.
We know.
Because I didn't see any of those movies, the Star Wars movies, until I was already mid-late teenager. I was in high school. So it didn't have that impact on me. I have no doubt whatsoever, had I saw them, when did it come out, 76, 77? Had I saw it when I was 11 years old, had I saw the original Star Wars when I was 11 years old, there is no doubt in my mind I would be a Star Wars fanatic. I know that. It's just, by chance, that wasn't what my mom liked. She wasn't a sci-fi person. She liked the drama. She liked the musicals. So that's what we saw growing up. But I there's no doubt in my mind, I would have loved those. My son, who now, thanks to the collection of Matt Hinshaw, we still got them.
Yeah, I know. You probably still have my DVD version.
Yeah, we've got the DVDs.
It's been almost a year now.
No, it's been like 3 years.
Or four, oh, jeez.
My son saw them when he was 7, and he loves them. So, again, no doubt in my mind, I would have been right. I would have probably started a comparable Bluemilk podcast type of thing, had that been what I was introduced to as a kid. So you seeing it at you know, pre-toddler, I'm sure is just
1 year old.
Yeah. Now, what do you remember, other than, like you said, the closing, the music? What, jump forward a year, 2 years, 3 years, whatever that memory starts hitting, what are some of the movies that you saw growing up that really stuck, aside from the original Star Wars?
Well, let's see. Movie-wise, I don't really remember anything specific until mid-80s.
Yeah.
Where when Back 9, to the 10-ish? Future came out.
Yeah.
Back to the Future was one that we saw in the theater. Ghostbusters was one that we saw in the theater.
Where did you grow up? What was childhood
Phoenix.
For you? In Phoenix?
Yeah.
What was it? Was there a theater you went to, or were there? Did you? Was there like one that your family went to?
There wasn't one specifically. There was one that I loved.
What was that one?
The Cine Capri downtown.
And why? What was the?
Just the screen, and it was. It's a used to be. I don't. Cine Capri got torn down 10 years ago or something
Cine
like that.
Capri
yeah, the original
was torn
Cine Capri.
Down actually even longer than that. I think it's closer to 20.
Oh, geez.
Because I've
now
only
I feel
ever
old.
Got
thanks.
To sit in the real Cine Capri like once.
Why was it so special? What was
it's huge.
It had a
it's
curved
enormous.
Screen. It was the only theater with a curved
like
screen.
Like CinemaScope
and the
thing?
Screen
yeah.
was huge.
Yeah, exactly.
Nice.
Yeah, it was
okay.
enormous. It sat 200-300 people, I think.
More than that. It was closer to about
700. It was a movie house. It wasn't a multiplex.
Huge. Well, and they revamped it. They brought it back, but it's not the same.
No.
There's the Cinema Capri. They bought the name and everything, Harkins, because I think Harkins originally bought the theater.
Yes.
And they have one in North Scottsdale, but it's not the same.
No,
I actually saw Metallica's Some Kind of Monster.
It's right off the 101, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes.
I've seen the sign. Okay. So going there, what describe what it was like going in as a kid, as a 9, 10-year-old kid at the Cinema Capri.
The first time I was there, it appears smaller than it is. It's an oval theater. And it doesn't look like it would hold very many people.
Yeah.
There were two aisles, only two aisles. There was no middle aisle for this theater. So you had to come in from two different directions and find a seat.
Yeah.
And walk through, if you got there late, you had to walk through all these people and everything. But what was really cool about it is when the just as the show started, or just before it started, about 10 minutes before, they'd put on classical music. So I had a love of music even back then.
The overtures.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And then the music would fade, and these curtains would go up and reveal this screen. And
yes.
It was so...
It was a reveal.
Yes. It was so cool.
It was an event to go to the theater.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. What, Maddie, you grew up in Sierra Vista. What was the movie situation when you were growing up?
When I was growing up, it was
Excuse me. When you were young, since you haven't grown up yet.
I hope never to grow up because then life will become boring.
Why are you looking at me?
Because I know Dirk hasn't grown up either.
I try to keep it hidden, man. Don't let my secrets out.
You have a podcast based solely on Star Wars.
Yeah, my mother brings that up, too.
So what was the theater situation?
It was rough. Being in a small town, military town, we had two theater options until I was in high school. It was a three-screen. I reminisce quite a bit on the Real Film Nerds podcast because my co-host also grew up in that town. He never went to the other theater, but we always went to R&M Cinema is what it was called. I think it's
R&M
now. R&M.
Like Robert Michael?
Yeah, I'm not sure what R&M stands for, but old guy owned it with his family. Three screens, that was it. So if a big movie came out, you only had one option because it was on all three screens. But I brought my notes, as you pointed out earlier, of multiple summer blockbusters that set me on fire. But the other screen, reminiscing about the Cine Capri, on the military base, they had a single theater, much like the Cine Capri, not as big, though. And it was enormous, giant screen. My father preferred going there because he was military. I don't know if he got discounts. I'm sure he did. But they even had a balcony and everything. And I remember vividly as a child going there and seeing, like, Braveheart. I was older with Braveheart. I think I was probably in middle school then. But every single time you'd walk in and same thing, curtains and all that stuff. And they just had the one balcony. They didn't have the side ones. It just was looked like a big cube. It's military.
Yeah.
Concrete cube is what it looked like. But it was the theater. And you'd walk in, and I remember... Every single time, right before, I don't even know if they showed previews, they might have, but they always had the national anthem, and they would have the American flag waving, and they had planes flying across the screen bombing stuff, and all kinds of just, you know,
propaganda!
Right, military propaganda, because we're seeing a movie on the military base, and my dad, granted, he was in the military 20 years, retired 20 years, you know, he did it until he was almost 40. And he would stand up just like everyone else. You had kind of had to, but he would stand up and he'd salute. And he hadn't saluted in 10, 15 years every single time. And I remember that vividly, every single movie. I was just like, at the point, I was like, man, do I have to get up again?
Hey, let's give the Hinshaws, Marie and Dave, a little shout out. They just celebrated 50 years
50
last
years,
week.
Man.
Well done,
yeah,
guys.
2 weeks ago. Yeah, beautiful. No, it was last week. They just left on Sunday to go back home.
Beautiful photo your mom posted, one of their wedding photos. And you know what? I can't believe how much your sister looks like your mom.
Yeah.
At that age. And your dad, man, they look sharp. They look sharp.
And I got to say,
congrats.
Your mom is awesome.
Yeah, my mom is very awesome.
Your mom is so cool.
She's a troublemaker.
I like her so much more than I like you.
Yeah.
Most people do.
She's been on this podcast before. Remember when we cornered her
down the hallway.
Now, growing up before you guys were born, we had a lot of theaters in the area I grew up in. There were three mainstream ones, the Southland Cinema, which was at the mall, separate from the mall, not like inside of it, but, you know, in the same parking lot. Then the Festival Cinemas, which I think was four screens. That was the big one. Southland was two.
Jeez.
Festival Cinema was four, and then the Hayward Cinema, which was two screens. Then they closed down for remodeling and opened as the Cinema 5. They added three screens.
In a town of 3,000.
No, we were like 100,000, 150,000.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
But it was when they closed down and reopened, it was huge. Five screens. And a couple years later, hey, come on over. A couple years later, the festival closed down and opened up as the Festival 9. And at that point, some of my buddies in high school were working there. So we used to go in there for free. So that was like the festival was – Southland was kind of the – where the older folks would go, and it was the family theater, you know, family movies, Disney and stuff. General Cinemas was the one. Do you guys remember General Cinemas? You know, like now there's Harkins and there's – what are some of the other ones?
Harkins is a statewide brand. Harkins originated in Arizona. Yeah. They've kind of taken over.
But General Cinemas.
The big ones, the national ones are like AMC, Cinemark, and stuff like that.
But, well, back then, they weren't even around. It was like Lowe's and things like that. I'm talking like years ago. But the General Cinemas used to have that intro before the, you know what? I'm going to pull it off of YouTube because I know it's there. I'm going to use that as either our intro and outro or outro music.
For the concession stand?
Yeah. And it was a...
remember that.
It was this really jazzy, almost Henry Mancini kind of...
Yeah,
then it was the dancing popcorn and the dancing soda.
Yep.
That was strictly General Cinemas. If you were seeing that, you were in a General Cinemas theater. That was Southland. Then it would go into the... Then it would go into the previews. The Cinema 5 or the Hayward Cinema... That was more of like all the Disney stuff would play there. The festival always had the bigger movies that would come out, the big blockbusters that we were talking about. And that was more of the place where like the high school kids went. And that was like the cooler place that came out. The theaters all had a different feel. And at that time, we had within bike riding distance... Three drive-in theaters.
Nice.
And I say bicycle distance because at 9, 10 years old, a whole nother time, this is long before perverts were invented, we used to drive our bikes, hop the fence, and stay out watching drive-in movies.
So that had to be within a 15-mile radius.
No, bike riding?
Yeah.
No. Probably three or four miles.
Still.
Yeah.
A lot farther than you're allowed to go now.
Oh, yeah. No. I wouldn't. I was 9, 10 years old. I wouldn't let my kid walk down the street. I don't. No way.
I know who lives in Chino Valley.
But we used to ride our bike. We used to take a sleeping bag, ride our bikes to the fence line, throw the sleeping bag over the fence because it had barbed wire, climb it, then set up our sleeping bags in a parking space and use a little speaker and watch drive-in movies.
Nice.
So, you know, there was movies everywhere where I grew up, but the festival played a pivotal role because when I was in high school, like I said, I had some older friends who worked there, and one of them, Luong Dang, was the manager, and we used to get in for free. So we would get in for free. We'd get free popcorn. And then as we got a little older, they would turn their eyes as we carried in not like a six-pack, not a bottle of beer. Take in camp coolers.
Nice.
That two people would have to carry. We'd walk them straight through the lobby and up to the projection booth. We'd watch movies from the projection booth. And we did other things up there. But this is a family show. We won't get into that.
So I'm about to open Pandora's box, and it's going to turn into a long answer by him. So why do you not like movies now if you grew up around movies?
I love movies
all the time. When was the last time you went to the movie theater?
To the theater? It's been a while. I love going to the theater.
Can you count that high?
I'm trying to think of what I saw last. It's been a while.
See, and I go to the theater once or twice a week.
No, I love the movies. Like I don't have time.
Oh, I understand.
This is an 18-hour day I'm working today. Tomorrow's just as long. I work 7 days a week. I don't have time. I love going to the movies. I love going to the theater. The other flip side of that is I don't like a lot of the movies that are out now. I just don't. I don't enjoy
watching them.
I love watching old movies. Now let's go back to the theaters that were in the area. The other one was a single screen, the Lorenzo, a single screen movie palace from like the 30s and 40s, and all they showed was old movies.
Nice.
Maltese Falcon, Citizen Kane, and then on Friday and Saturday nights they would run Quadrophenia, Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Oh, I did that
9-hour. Three Stooges marathons. You know, they would do that type of stuff. So we would go to the, and it was beautiful, velvet seats. It was run down. You know, was old. But it was, you'd walk in, and it was the big screen. There was a stage in front of the screen. Yep. And so that was, we would go see older movies. West Side Story, I saw that there on the big screen. They had a binder at the ticket booth where you could write down your what you would like to have them bring, and then you'd, you know, to the theater, and you'd give them your name and your telephone number. And if they brought your movie to the theater, you know, 6 months down the road or 8 months, whatever it happens, they would call you and you would get 2 free tickets for suggesting it.
That's
cool.
So
we would put up things like, you know, old James Garner movies, you know, Operation Petticoat, you know, stuff, you know.
Maverick.
It was a TV show at the time. Yeah. But so we would always do, I think we got called one. Support Your Local Sheriff was one that got called. And I got free tickets. And then the Bow Theater that my mom grew up going to had long since closed, then reopened as a Spanish-only theater. So I've never set foot in there. But in recent years, it was bought. It's still there, and they remodeled. They did the. They restored it back to its original 1920s and 30s glory.
Wow.
And it's a concert venue, live music. They do comedy shows there and things like that. It's a big palace where they do special events and fundraisers and things. I'd like to go back because I've never stepped foot in that theater.
Do you want a local connection to something very similar to what you're describing right now? The Elks Opera House over here does a summer movie.
Guess what's playing
series.
There tonight?
And we're missing it. What?
The Blues Brothers.
Oh, man.
Because, yeah, what they do is they bring in...
Speaking of summer
unquote,
blockbusters.
We'll get there because I've got a story about
movies. They're not that old, but it's 80s, 90s, sometimes 70s. Sometimes
they've had
60s.
Some older ones. Oh, yes, well, Junior Bonner. Bonner's there every year.
Yeah, of course, because it's film here. But, I mean, you know, last year I think they had Days of Thunder, they had Top Gun, they did a lot of crews last year. But
they had some older ones. They would pepper in a couple of classics, too.
Yeah, they did, believe it or not, they did a Scarface there, I think, once.
Oh, wow.
So they've done a wide
they mix
variety,
it up.
And it's typically just the summer when they do it.
And let's plug them.
Awesome.
I'll put a link in the notes because it's, and I don't remember the exact website because it's not. I think it's the Historic Elks.
It used to be
or whatever.
ElksOperaHouse.com, but it might be Historic Elks.
But what their
because you know those
what,
new people bought it.
But what their entry is a donation. It's a suggested donation, so you can go in for a couple of bucks if you want.
Obviously,
many people will drop in more because it helps support the program over there and other things they do. But it's such a beautiful theater. It's such a beautiful spot.
I think it started out as like it was like $2 or $3, and then it went to $2 or $3 donation. I don't know.
Now it's just a donation. It's a donation. Yeah, because I looked at it several months ago. They were doing a. They were doing a movie I wanted to go to, and I didn't get a chance. So I'm pulling it up right now.
And that's another good one about Harkins, especially ours local, and why I love Harkins in general, even though they're an Arizona chain, and they are a chain, but they're just mostly in Arizona.
Give them the website, Maddie.
It's PrescottElksTheater.com. So we both were way off.
We're not. Google Prescott Elks Theater.
Google
it'll pop up. But yeah, and it all goes to a good cause. And they got some great movies over there.
Harkins does Tuesday night classics at most, if not all, of
yes,
the theaters.
That's right.
Even though we're just little podunk Prescott, our theater's
Prescott Valley
Plex, which is in my world is still huge.
Yeah,
but they do Tuesday night classics, and they do the same thing. Every Tuesday they have a classic movie, something that's not a current run, and it's great because they don't charge the full price. It's $4 too, but it's cool because you can see movies that some of us young people did not get to see on the big screen.
You're
so
full of it.
You know,
now let's go back. I want to go back to the Elks Theater. Luong Dang, who is the manager, who owns, I should pull it up, he owns a Vietnamese guy that I grew up with owning a Mexican restaurant in Pleasanton, California. It's supposed to be dynamite. I've never been. He used to be the manager, and then one of the other managers and a guy I'm still hooked up with on Facebook is Lenny Green. They were a couple years older than me. So that's how we used to get in free to the theater. I'm burning them now. What's the statute of limitations on sneaking your friends into movies? When they closed, they were the Nineplex, Then they closed and went to like 16. They were rebuilding for 16, and then it's gone now. It's a Home Depot or something now. But I think the last incarnation was like a 27 screen theater, which is basically like seven seats and a large TV screen. You know, when it gets down to it. But when they closed from the 9 to go to the teens, whatever it was, 16, 17 screens, they needed to still be open to generate money. So they would close one of the 6, remodel it, close another one, remodel it, and add on. So, and I don't remember the movie, but it was one of those that they would get the film like on Thursday night, but it was for a Friday premiere. So they asked us, we were all hanging out at Daly's, a bar in the mall, and they called us up and said, hey, come on over. We got a screen that's available. So at about 2 o'clock in the morning, and I don't even remember the movie. It might have been like a Beverly Hills Cop, one of the Beverly Hills Cops or something. But the theater, this is how they remodeled it. They ripped the roof off, but the screen was there and all the seats were there. So we were sitting in basically a convertible.
It was a sit-in, drive-in theater. Yeah.
And we went in at 2 o'clock in the morning, and they played this movie as we were all sitting in there just getting whacked. You know, it was a lot of fun. I don't remember what movie, obviously, but it was a lot of fun. So a lot of good memories of the festival. That's a whole other story. when the Blues Brothers came out in 19, what was that, 80, 81? I think it was 80 or 81.
Oh, you know what? I think it was actually 70s.
No. 70s. Google it real quick. Yeah, it's either 80 or 81.
I'm not connected to the internet. I don't pay for that.
I don't know when it was. Whatever it was, 80-ish. No, it's free.
I'm thinking 79.
They got free internet here.
Oh, do they?
Yeah.
So they're spying on me too, like Google?
But when
everybody's
it came out,
spying on you.
My brother.
Hold on here. Okay, Google.
Oh, jeez.
When did the Blues Brothers come out?
1980.
So you said 81, yeah, June 16th, so it was a summer movie.
So when it came out, living in the East Bay, I was the youngest. My brother, 3 years older than me, and then a friend of ours, Ricky, who was 2 or 3 years older than my brother, we got on the BART train, which was, you know, the public transit, and took the train over to San Francisco, bounced around San Francisco during the day, then hopped on a Muni. I was 14 in 80, 14 or 15 in 80. Then we hopped on a Muni train and went to South City, the drive-in next door to the Cow Palace in San Francisco, which is basically Hunter's Point, the roughest neighborhood on the West Coast at the time, before Compton was rough. This was Hunter's Point was the roughest here. So a 14-year-old kid, his 17-year-old brother, and a 19, 20-year-old friend, all day gone in San Francisco, then take a bus to a drive-in, hop the fence, and watch the Blues Brothers, and then got back on the BART train and came home at about 2 o'clock in the morning.
How many beers of cooler? How many?
No, well done.
At that point, at 14, none.
A little dyslexic.
No.
Yeah.
At that point, nothing. Yeah, it was just a different world back then, man.
Oh,
it was
yeah.
just a strange, strange.
I would do the same thing, be out another, all day.
This flashing forward a little bit. Do you guys, now this is what, 87, 88-ish? You're going to have to refresh my memory. Maybe 89. When U2's.
A lot of snowfall during those times.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and that's part of the story. U2's Joshua Tree album was out, and the tour, mid-late 80s.
Yeah.
And we went and saw them. If you guys, I don't know if you, were you U2 fans at all? Or
there were some songs I like. I wasn't a huge fan.
Joshua Tree and Boy,
I love
two of the greatest albums. When they were touring that, they did a free concert at Justin Herman Plaza in San Francisco before the Coliseum shows. And there was this big art sculpture, whatever. It was a big fountain. It looked like Lego blocks, but it was a fountain that this artist had done at Justin Herman Plaza. And Bono's out there singing and they're playing, and he spray-painted something on the sculpture. Peace or End War, you know, something, whatever was in his craw at that point. During the concert, he did it, and it went over great. Well, then people got in an outrage. The next night at the Coliseum, I was at the concert. I was at the concert for two shows that weekend. He brought the artist out, because the artist was all, yeah, we don't care, this is, it's free speech. And the artist was painting on the stage, so it was kind of a big
thing. Great.
This is at a point in my life when things were not as they are today. There were various fungi consumed. There were various herbages intake. There was lots of liquids taken, and there were many powders ingested.
That really hasn't changed much. We just
for me it has.
Keep
for,
it quiet.
For me it has. But back then, ew, it was a buffet. It was a unlicensed pharmacist sizzler going on at that point. And that whole weekend was just a blur. We ended up stage front at some point at the Coliseum, and our tickets were third deck.
Impressive.
We don't know what happened. I don't know what happened. Now, they were filming that entire tour for the documentary Rattle and Hum.
Are you in it?
No.
Oh.
But when Rattle and Hum came out, we went to the festival to see it. Me and my good friend, Bobby Garcia, and we went to a 10 a.m. matinee. We started at 6 a.m. at the Palm Villa, a nice little neighborhood bar across from Chabot College. So by 10 a.m., we're getting tickets to see Rattle and Hum, which vaguely is only a year old, year and a half old in our mind from being at the Coliseum. It was 45 minutes into this showing at a 10:30, 10 a.m. showing at the Festival Cinema where there was maybe seven people in the theater on a Tuesday morning. 45 minutes into it before it clicked that we weren't at a live show. So the two of us standing screen side at the Festival Cinema doing who knows what while 6 80-year-olds are staring at us, wondering if they should call the cops behind us.
Yes,
it was a memorable, memorable movie.
I was going to say, you might not remember, but I'm sure it's in the police report.
Oh, I'm sure it is.
All right, Maddie, hit your notes. What are some of your blockbusters you remember?
Jesus. Wow. All right, well.
Wait, we're going to take a commercial break before Matt hits his notes. We'll be right back at the Mile High Show after these messages. Okay, we had to take a quick little break at the Raven, so I will remind you of this. Use the Amazon link at milehighshow.com for all your online shopping. It's free to use. You click on it. It takes you to your Amazon or Amazon Prime login page. You do your shopping. We get a little kickback, a little money in our pocket. You get your stuff delivered to your home. It's a win-win situation. So use that Amazon link at milehighshow.com. Now back to the Real Film Nerds Bluemilk Podcast and Mile High Show combo at the Raven in Prescott, Arizona. Don't forget, do whatever that ad said to do.
I didn't know we were back. Whatever it is, buy it.
All right, man. Yeah, buy it.
Mile High Show.
Buy it, spend it, use it, click it. Whatever I said a minute ago, do that.
Now, if you want to hear stuff really about movies, make sure and listen to the Real Film Nerds Podcast.
Agreed.
Where we don't talk about the movie theaters that we go to. We just talk about the movies.
He needs more than four listeners.
Hey, you know, four is plenty. I'm one of your listeners, as you saw I commented the other day.
Yes, thank you.
Because you guys talked about me for a while, and him. But he doesn't listen to you because he doesn't like Star Wars.
No. Well, and we're filthy. We are so filthy.
You're filthy. Filthy, filthy individuals.
We're dirty.
Speaking of filthy,
oh, no.
Matt's going to tell us what he used to do in the theater.
Shall
at
we?
Summer Blockbusters.
Before Pee Wee Herman.
Oh, jeez.
Only in Florida and Sierra Vista.
All right. So I got a list, and these are just big summer blockbusters, I guess I would say, to me. The first one I really remember that made a huge difference or impact on me was the original Batman. Well, not the original Batman. Michael Keaton's Batman.
Who's that, 89?
1989. And I saw that.
Wait till they get a load of me.
Yeah, I saw that at R&M Cinema. And even though I grew up in a small town of, back then it was 25, 30,000. Now it's about 55, 60. The line still wrapped all the way around the building to get in to see that movie. And if you wanted to see it, you had to stand in line.
That was a huge release.
Yes, it was.
It was something that was anticipated because, quite frankly, up until, when did the Superman come out with
Christopher Reeves was the 80s.
That was early
80s.
It was like, I always get the dates mixed up, but like I think the first one came out in like 80, 81. but all of them just...
Star Wars, huge. Obviously huge.
Yes.
Pre that, the Planet of the Apes were huge.
Yes.
But sci-fi, fantasy, at that time frame, 70s and 80s, was a television medium. That's what used to come on.
Right.
With the exception of what we just said. And even some of the, you know, Planet of the Apes is great, but it's a little, you know, especially viewed in the 2019 lens, you know, it's guys in
primitive.
Suits.
Primitive. It's primitive.
But there weren't, pun intended, but there weren't superhero movies, really. There was Shazam on TV. There was Greatest American Hero. There were some TV shows, but there weren't big superhero movies, with the exception of Superman beforehand. But that was even... They did that almost nostalgic kind of. It was more of a almost like a cartoony the way they portrayed it. It was a great movie, but the way they did it, Batman was pretty darn dark.
Yeah, but it still was quite cartoony, quite silly in comparison to superhero films today.
Yeah,
thanks to our good buddy director Tim Burton.
It brought the comic book to life,
and we hadn't seen Batman before 66. I mean, since 66.
There was
Adam
also,
West.
Well, the cheesy Batman.
Yeah, there was an Adam West film.
Got it at home.
The Batman, but it was actually a made-for-TV movie. That was never in the theaters.
No, it was.
It might have been.
We saw it at the drive-ins.
It originally aired on the TV.
No, what they did is it was a feature film, but then they released it. They broke it up into episodes. For a
That's
TV,
what it was,
but no, it was
it
for
together as a movie.
Robin, get the shark repellent. Anthony watches it at least once a month. We've got it on disc.
A poor child.
He loves it. But no, that's a great one because that was an event movie.
Yes,
that was something people were waiting for. You mentioned the Back to the Future franchise.
Right.
Now I remember when that came out because there was a lot of Northern California connections to that because where there was some of the places it was filmed and stuff.
Yes.
Huey Lewis doing the soundtrack. Yes. He was a Marin County guy. So that was really exciting where I grew up. And that was, I mean, aside from obviously Star Wars and the franchise and The Godfather and things like that, in my memory, and correct me if I'm wrong, that was one of the first big sequel franchise things.
Yeah,
am I missing
it was,
out?
It was, and it wasn't a huge blockbuster smash hit in the theaters. It did well, but in comparison to today, it's not, you know, for then it was equivalent of a blockbuster, but it didn't light the world on fire. It did good enough to warrant two more sequels.
What a neat... I love that. I'm
not only that, but because of the dates that were presented in the movies, it
85,
came back.
Yeah.
It came back, and it built again.
Well, and it also helped with the time period that they were traveling back to, because you're getting the young kids because of the sci-fi. You're getting the parents
for the nostalgia.
Because of the nostalgia of the 50s.
Yeah.
That's why my father watched it.
I haven't visited it. I haven't seen it in a long time. It's on a lot of the streaming systems and things, but does it hold up? Have you guys seen it recently?
It does, to a level.
Yeah. There are... A good portion of it is kind of accurate.
Yeah.
But we still don't have our flying cars.
Well, no,
they
I just
were
mean
supposed to be here in 2015.
Well,
man.
I mean, not
well,
back to the
or do we?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Or do
yeah,
we?
Yeah.
Maybe the man's keeping them down like those water-powered combustion engines. No, but just as far as like the humor and the look of it, does it hold up?
Okay.
The only thing that kind of falls apart, but again, it was an 80s movie, is the special effects. But you have to understand, that was the time period, that was the best technology they had at that time.
Yeah.
So they did the best they could with what they had. I mean, today, I was having this discussion fairly recently with Mike. Endgame came out April, which... drives me nuts that Disney and Marvel have now made the summer movie intro start in April.
Yeah.
It's always been May, but now they push it to April. That kind of pisses me off, but fine, whatever. I still went and saw it. But I loved Endgame. It's probably one of the biggest blockbusters of my lifetime for sure. I saw it opening night. Loved it. Recommend everybody go see it. But it's getting to the point where a lot of these huge movies, and I don't know how the actors do it. I really don't. They stand in a room, and it's just green.
Yeah.
It's like watching a video game. Granted, it's a really well-crafted, beautiful-looking video game, but that's what it is. And it kind of drives me nuts. I like the traditional filmmaking. I like the in-game stuff, but I wish, you know, people would use their minds, their ingenuity, people that can build sets, people that can paint sets,
yeah.
people that can make props more. And a movie we reviewed, not super recently, but it was called Unsane. It's about a girl that thinks she's completely sane, logical, and gets locked up in a mental institution because she goes there to talk to someone, and they just lock her up. It was 100% shot on an iPhone. It is a well-known director. It was a well-known writer, but they shot it on an iPhone, the whole freaking movie, and it does not look like it. You can tell at times if you're familiar, yeah. but they use their mind. There's no CGI, none of that stuff, and it was a fantastic film.
Nice. Interesting. I miss, and again, like you'd mentioned it. I don't go to the movies like you guys do. One, again, I'm not a big fan of most of the stuff that comes out.
Or people,
for that matter. But honestly, that's one of the great things about a theater, is you can walk in, and that pageantry you were talking about, Dirk, about the curtains opening and the lights going and the overture music and things. When you walk into a theater, I compare it to like when you walk into a ball game. I love going to baseball games. I'm not the biggest baseball fan. I'm not the guy that can spout off stats and batting averages and records and things. But there's something about walking through, especially if you're in an outdoor stadium, when you walk through the tunnel and either the bright lights and the bright green grass or the blue sky on a daytime game, there's just something about walking out and getting that smack in the face. Same thing at a theater. You walk in, it's quiet. Now you have to deal with things like cell phones. Your cell phone's off. You can't pause it and go to the bathroom. You can't stop the movie, you know, if the phone rings or whatever. You're in there. You're locked in, hopefully, engaged in what's going on that screen. And you don't have to look at people on either side of you because it's dark. It's not like watching a movie in the front room.
But you do have to listen to them and yeah. their children.
You know, and there's something for that. I like I said, growing up, going as a family to the movie, my mom would, and I didn't realize this till later, she would cherry pick when we would go, when there were other families there, for that reason.
Because, yes.
you know, she's got five kids, and we're asking questions, and we get fidgety during the slow parts and things. So now in hindsight, I realize, she picked and chose when we went. But there's something to that. As a kid, I knew when we got to the movie, we weren't going to be rambunctious like we weren't. It was not like at home. I took my son to his very first movie. I don't remember what it was. I want to say it might have been Planes.
I remember you told me it was either Planes or Cars. It wasn't the original Cars, but it was like Cars 3 or something.
No, I want to say Planes. It was Planes.
I think it was Planes because I remember you called me about it.
He was 5, and it was the first time we took him into a theater. I took him in. My wife still doesn't like it because we did it while she was at work, and she missed out on it. But we walk in, and he's a big popcorn nut, like our whole family is. We grew up, that was every night, had popcorn. My dad would make it on the stove. So we walked in, and he got to get popcorn. We treated him. He got a lemonade. We got him some candy. And we walked in, and I kept telling him, Anthony, if you have to use the bathroom, you got to do it now. No, I'm fine. No, go to the bathroom. And we walk in, and he saw, and at the time, Maddie, thanks to Matt Hinshaw, we have a very large 65, 70-inch TV right now that he stole from a neighbor who was on vacation. Shh. I don't know what happened with it, but he ended up giving it to us. But before that...
Well, you know who you'd think. You know where I got that, right?
I don't remember which.
Was DJ Sheridan.
Okay. Oh, was it
Sheridan
DJ?
Sheridan Property Group.
Okay.
So
thanks, DJ.
So you can thank him directly.
Huge
but he doesn't
TV.
Listen to your podcast either. So
no. He was on it once. The only podcast I've never aired. DJ Sheridan.
I've heard his clip. It was fantastic. It was Bluemilk podcast quality.
At the time.
Lots of swears.
At the time, what we watched TV on was a laptop. That was our TV. We had a DVD player hooked up to a 20-inch old big tube TV, but we would watch on a laptop. That's what we watched on. And we went from that to his first visit to a theater at Harkins, and his eye, he didn't know what to do. And we went during the day so that knowing that he would probably, you know, make some noise or he might even get scared or, you know, who knows. We sat in the middle, and we sat there about 20 minutes into the movie. He leans over. He goes, "Pop, I got to go to the bathroom. Pause it." I said, "Buddy, there is no pausing."
That way.
So we had to run out real quick and run back in. And he loves going to the theater. I love going to the theater. It's just, you know, to walk in and be able to sit down and focus in. I still love the previews. I love watching previews.
Oh, absolutely.
That's like one of the best parts.
Well, I don't want to interrupt because this is a topic Mysterious Mike and I talk about frequently, especially going to the theaters, why both of us go to the theaters. We've even spent episodes where we shouldn't have. We should have reviewed the movie, but it turned from a half-hour episode into an hour-long because half an hour we talked about what the benefit of going to the theater is, why we prefer going to the theater over sitting there streaming, what the benefits of streaming are versus going to the theater. And one of the most biggest hot-button topics for me, especially here, is going to picture show and people being jackasses. I don't ever remember this.
They don't know how to act.
Growing up as a kid. Yeah. Adults, parents and their kids, you name it, they don't know how to act. They talk. I had a couple. Yeah. It was a two, probably in their 70s, maybe even 80s, ladies that literally started talking when previews started, stopped talking when the credits rolled. Two older ladies. If you want to sit there and talk through an entire movie, go Starbucks here at the Raven. Go
watch
somewhere
it at
else.
Home. Watch
go
the movie
else.
At home.
Yes.
They
where
talk
you can
the whole
pause
thing.
It. Yes.
And I asked them multiple times to be quiet, and they wouldn't because I'm some young punk and they're, you know, seniors. But that was the newest Liam Neeson movie, Taken in the Snow. It was it's not Taken in the Snow, but that's what I always called it. I don't remember the name of the movie. But it was where he gets revenge and he's a snowplow truck driver. I went off for most of that podcast about these ladies talking. It was awful.
But that whole experience, and I use that word deliberately, the experience of going to the theater is magical. I love it. I absolutely love it.
Yes.
Coupled with that, I would like to see a movie that, now granted, there are especially the superhero, the sci-fi movies, where you want to see them on the big screen. And I understand that.
There are some, yes.
There are some that you definitely want to see on the big screen. But to be able to go into a theater and be completely engaged by what's going on the screen, honestly, for me and for my interests, a lot of the movies don't grab me like that now. A lot of the older ones
no.
do. Now, having said that, I'm like so far away from most pop culture references just because busy and old and
old,
and lame and everything
point
else.
Out old.
I don't always know about movies until long after they've been released. So I see them on a streaming service, on Amazon, on Netflix or something like that, just because I'm not in touch with what's going
that
on.
Really makes me laugh because the woman and I, we have come across movies, and how did we miss that? How did we not know that was in the theater? This is a great movie. There's been several over the last few years that we've done that with.
So the pluses of...
So listen to the Real Film Nerds podcast, and you'll know which movies to go see and which ones not to go see.
I've tried listening
to your
podcast.
I'm trying to get listener number five.
So,
listener number five,
oh, okay.
Dirk, you can do it.
So I'm 4.5, man. Come on.
The pluses of the theater experience are the complete immersion, the pageantry of going there, especially...
I agree.
Especially if you can go to a larger theater. There's something about not being in a closet with six other people watching
yes.
the TV screen.
Yes.
Well, today, another huge one today is the technology. Granted, home theater technology, just your regular TV, has come a long way, as you alluded to earlier. Yeah. You know, we grew up watching tube TVs, VHS,
Waiting 3 or 4 minutes for the TV to heat up.
Right. It's really come a long way at home, but it's still not a theater. You go into a theater, that's a multi-$1,000 projector that's projecting at 4K, even at the crappy small theaters, because that's what they have to have, with an extremely bright bulb, with a surround sound system that, you know, you could take a second mortgage out on.
Right.
You know, and you don't have that at home. And so you get to enjoy that for the $8 or $9, whatever it is now, to go see a movie. And so that, yes, the home theater experience is a lot better. I got surround sound at home. I have a okay TV. It's not incredible. It's okay. It's a hell of a lot better than it's ever been. But it's still not the level of going to a theater. Not in my opinion.
I agree, and that is something that I always work towards, is getting that theater experience in the home. And we recently moved, and I used to have a really nice sounding system, and I haven't been able to hook it up because the new house doesn't have the same setup.
Yeah, well, I shot your old house. And I know, I saw the wires and all dude, that's one of those things about some of the newer quote-unquote premium homes, is they are pre-hardwired for surround sound. A lot of them are.
Oh, the new one was. The new one will be.
Yeah.
It's just going to take time.
Take time, yeah.
I'm looking something up right now because my brain doesn't work, and obviously I didn't do any pre-prep for this.
I'll continue my list.
Well, no, I want to Irwin Allen.
No, he doesn't want you to talk anymore.
Real quick. No, we'll get there. We'll get there.
Because that's only one sheet.
Because you mentioned how the technology in the theaters now, no question about it. It's head and shoulders above everything 5 years ago, let alone 40 years ago.
Yes.
It's just the crispness, the sound, the...
I'll tell you one better. Even my days of high school, granted it's getting longer and longer as we go, but Mysterious Mike Talent, he alludes about it, he's talked about it a little bit. In high school, actually I think it was maybe out of high school, might have been freshman year of college, he was running the projections. He was a projectionist at the big theater back home in the mall. It was a 12-plex, I think is what it is now. But back then, it was still film. And he got to learn how to cut and do trailers. His job was running up and down and hitting those switches so the different platters would kick in for the next reel and all that stuff.
So
and
now,
that was not even that long ago.
So now all you got to do is push a button.
Now it's literally they push a button.
Now,
it's crazy.
The big... huge things. You talked about at the Cinema Capri, CinemaScope. There was the, drop back even farther than that, surround sound and Technicolor, different thing. Not even touching on things like 3D and things like that. But now, do you guys know who Irwin Allen is? Who's a producer?
I've heard the name.
Irwin Allen was a producer, late 60s, early 70s, mid 70s.
Give me a movie.
Towering Inferno,
yes.
Earthquake.
Yes, yes.
I believe he did the airport movies, I think.
Yes. I think
he
right.
was known for these blockbuster disaster movies. Again, flip back the local connection. Towering Inferno came out in 74. I just had to look it up. Filmed in San Francisco. The buildings that they used, we knew we would see. So when we went to the theater to see this, it was incredible. He came out with a movie called Earthquake, set in L.A., but we grew up on the San Andreas and the Hayward Fault, so we knew about earthquakes. It would happen every couple of days. The movie Earthquake, when it came out, we traveled from Hayward 30, 40 miles to downtown San Jose to see it because they had, and I forget what they called it, but it was a specific sound system they installed in select theaters around the country specifically for Earthquake. What it was speakers under the seat. So when the earthquake hit, your chair would move.
That's great.
And it was almost, if you, what was that movie came out? Oh, I don't know, maybe late 80s, early 90s with John Goodman about a theater. It was set in the 50s or early 60s. John Goodman was a movie producer or something, publicity guy. It was set around the Cuban Missile Crisis in Florida.
Wag the Dog, where they fake it, right?
No, Wag the Dog was a political movie.
Yeah, I thought that's what
you're
talking
about. No, this was
a
movie set in like the 60s.
Oh.
And he was...
Well done, Henshaw.
Yeah, he was, John Goodman played this guy who was doing basically like a Alfred Hitchcock or the blah. It was a whole horror movies. And the movie he was promoting was so scary, you can't leave the theater because... And they had like nurses and firemen in the theaters, you know, actors. And it was, you know, when they were talking about, you know, 3D was extreme. They would have smell-o-vision where if there was a fire, they would put smoke in the theater. You know, all these kitschy things. Well, that I went to one of those movies to see Earthquake where the chairs would shake. It was a huge thing. We traveled, you know, an hour to go see this movie just to feel those chairs move.
Disneyland took on that and a lot of their, Universal Studios as well. They do that now. They put you in a chair, and there's a movie screen, and you are part of what's going on.
I'll do you one better. They actually have a name for this today. It is called 4D. There are a handful of theaters in the country that do it. The seats are programmable. They have programming engineers that program the seats to vibrate, to spray water in your face.
I have heard of that.
Do the smells. Which is really interesting.
Some movies where they really don't want it.
Depending on what you're watching.
Like Endgame was one that they were promoting big time in 4D, where, you know, if Thor was going by, you'd smell, I don't know how you smell.
Sweat and metal?
But like rain, and because he's the god of thunder and all this stuff. And it
just because there's thunder doesn't mean there's rain,
what's
man.
What's crazy is that the tickets for him to go see a 4D movie is like $50.
That's not going to happen.
Not for me.
All right, what's up? What else is on your list, Maddie?
Well, these are all just the big blockbusters.
Go.
The second one that was very impactful to me was Terminator 2, July 1st, 91. And why that was impactful?
I was in my 30s.
It was just like Batman. It was wrapped around the building. But for me, that was my first rated R movie.
Impressive.
And we snuck in. Because I was nowhere near the age of getting in trouble for that. 91,
what else you got?
I was 10.
Bust through them. What do you got?
The other one that's extremely impactful I touched on earlier is Endgame. For those of you who have not seen it, Endgame does set a new bar for Blockbuster. Now, for those of you who have not paid attention to most of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, it is not going to do anything for you. It's just going to be, it's a cool movie. But if you paid attention to at least 6 of the 22 films that's in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, it's incredible. It's a great end cap of a film. Dirk's
almost
looking at me like,
he's
gonna strangle me.
I almost made it through Infinity Wars. Almost. Couldn't do it.
Infinity War completely turned me off. I was so unhappy with Infinity War.
Well, see, I'm
so I am
nerd.
Not
I loved
excited.
It was on that level.
I'm not excited at all about Endgame.
Dude, Endgame is something else. It takes, like, Infinity War was good, but...
You know what it takes? Endgame, you know what it takes? 3 hours of your life.
It does that. It does that, too.
Exactly. I might end up looking like him.
No. It takes a lot more than this. He's lived a hard life, too.
But he looks younger than you do.
You know what that is? That's from shaving his head. If he grows that out, it's nothing but white, buddy.
Okay.
I can't shave my head. It would be real bad. But no, Endgame set
Or your face.
Bar.
Or your back, for that matter.
I don't like doing that either. I don't have hair on my back.
All right, what else? Give us some more movies.
No,
come on.
Well, I'm done now. Quick, you're getting mean.
Real quick.
I'll steal
real
your notes.
Real film nerds. Says I should watch it, so I am going to watch it.
Stop it.
What do you got?
Stop it. It's the Star Wars movies.
Oh, okay.
It's
the
Star Wars movies.
No. So you can't talk anymore. No. We're going to talk Star Wars.
No. So for you listening out there, obviously you guys all, and I'm including the listeners here, love the franchise. So that's no news to you guys. You want to know more about them? Real Film Nerds covered most of them. Bluemilk Podcast, a constant barrage of Star Wars stuff. So great blockbusters, great list. Thanks for doing the homework.
But this is what I'm going to say. I did not get to see any of the originals in the theaters. I was way too young. The summer before Episode 1 came out, or actually it was more than the summer. I think it was a couple years.
When they
re-released
yeah.
all of them. It was the George Lucas re-release.
Language.
Write it down. Write it down.
Man.
Santos,
but
he beat me. I didn't do it.
Filthy. Now we know why. No one listens to real film nerds.
That's right. You are a filthy
rot. The rot that goes through their ears.
If you think what I say is bad, you clearly have never watched the Bluemilk podcast.
I have.
You know what I mean? Nobody watches. Well,
dude, they even dabbled into politics.
Go ahead. Go.
So, all right, they re-released them. I saw all of them in the theater with my buddies. We stood in line to see them because there were lines.
Where did you see them?
And there we had our new theater. It was called Uptown 3. So it was just like Arnhem. It still exists today. Arnhem shut down. The other one's still there. It's another 3-screen theater. Crappy seats. Crappy screens, the usual. But they're still there. All
right.
So I saw all three of them. And then my senior year, Episode 1 came out. So I went and stood in line for that, and heavily disappointed like everybody else.
You make me feel so damn old. Would you quit?
Episode 2 came out when I was in college. I stood in line with that for my girlfriend. And Episode 3 was even more momentous. I stood in line for hours with my girlfriend on that one because I stood in line with her for Harry Potter. The benefit of Episode 3 was I was now over 21 years old by a couple years then. The movie theater I went to was in Ahwatukee. I couldn't get the Harkins Tempe that was right next to my apartment. I couldn't get that. I wanted to. So I got Ahwatukee. But I found out the Ahwatukee one had the bookstore stayed open late, and the bar obviously was open. So we took turns. I'd be like, okay, you want to go check out something? She'd go wander and go get something to eat or go get ice cream or go to the bookstore, and I go to the bar. So
that works.
We did that, and when midnight finally rolled around and they let us in the theater, I enjoyed Episode 3 because I was a little tipsy.
See, like I said, I'm like way behind.
I still enjoy it.
I'm like way behind on the pop culture references on a lot of things. So when the first time I saw any of the Star Wars at the theater was when they were re-released before Episode 1. Went with my wife because she is a hardcore Star Wars nut. And I enjoyed all of them. I enjoyed them all because, you know, I saw the re-releases. They were fine. They were okay. And then Episodes 1, 2, and 3, I enjoyed because I had nothing to compare them really to. So I watched. And then when people started saying, this is ridiculous, this is horrible, I'm like, I don't understand. It's just as good as the ones that I saw a year ago because I had nothing. I didn't have. Well, I didn't have that strong base of being so impacted at an earlier age.
Stop it. Dirk's going to have a stroke.
I probably will.
I saw them all within a few years, so it was kind of like, well, yeah, they didn't have that much of an impact. So I'll say it right now, watch him stroke out.
One of my favorite man here, he's going to die of a stroke.
One of my favorite characters was Jar Jar Binks.
Ah, no!
You know what would be
he was just can't be on your show anymore.
He was just goofy. He was silly. I didn't care. You know, it's like, he's fun.
There's a real sad story behind that actor, too. The actor that played him, because in Episode 1, it was a guy standing there with a Jar Jar mask on his head and some green stuff that they cut out later. It was the dude that full-on was in it.
He got all the social media
too. And he tried to kill himself.
Yeah. And who really wanted that part? Who lobbied for
Michael
that
Jackson,
part?
Yeah.
He wanted that part. Then when he found out it was going to be a lot of CGI, he said he didn't want to do it.
That would have just made me laugh.
But, again, had I seen the original Star Wars in 77, there's no doubt in my mind I would have been locked in like you guys were. I didn't see any of them until after high school. I would have been.
I'm sure it did not affect people the same way it affected me.
Yeah.
I'm sure.
Now, the summer or two summers before that, 75...
Jaws.
I saw a major blockbuster at 9 years old.
Oh, I would have
loved
that.
And we sat in the second row because we got there late. My mom took us all. I was the youngest. I was 9. My sister, who is seven years older than me, I was 9. She was 16. To this day, she is 60, has not seen the entire Star Wars because she was so freaked out. Now, Family on a budget.
She hasn't seen Star Wars.
No,
because
Jaws.
She saw Jaws.
No, she
you
hasn't.
Said Star Wars.
Did I? I'm sorry.
Yeah.
She hasn't seen the entire Jaws movie because of
maybe he's having
her.
A stroke.
Maybe.
No. So, growing up, a lot of kids, family on a budget. Our freezer was stocked with, you know,
fish
leftovers. No meat. Oh, it was
okay.
A pork roast.
Okay. Okay.
In wrapped in cellophane, she would for a year after we saw Jaws. She would not open the freezer because the wrapped meat was... She was so freaked out. 20 minutes into the movie, she wanted to leave. She was sitting in front of us with her friend, Noel Bonick. They were sitting in front of us in the very first row of the theater. She was so freaked out, she would not exit the theater because she did not want to turn her back to the screen. Now, my son, who is now 9 years old, sees Jaws up on our DVD. We have Jaws. We have, like, the anniversary edition. It is, to this day, one of my favorite movies.
That made well done.
It is, to this day, one of my favorite movies. So when the anniversary edition came out on DVD, we bought it, whatever blankety-blank anniversary that was several years ago.
Right.
My son, like most 7, 8, 9, 10-year-old kids, boys, loves dinosaurs, but his all-time favorite thing in the world is sharks. So he sees that DVD up on the shelf, and for 3, 4 years now, he goes, Pop, when can I watch Jaws?
Okay, I was waiting for him to say, my 9-year-old watched Jaws.
No.
Wait, what's the reaction?
No, I'm telling him. I think I told him when he was 16 he can watch it.
That's a good age. I think I watched it first when I was 12 or 13.
So I saw it and was completely freaked out.
A little bit,
at 9 years old. But still, to this day, one of my favorite movies of all time.
One of my all-time favorites.
So I am really looking forward to 5, 6, 7, 8 years from now watching that on DJ Sheridan's 70-inch TV that's in our in our family room with my son. To see him watch that and then get yelled at by my wife
for letting him. Absolutely.
Mike and I reviewed Jaws. It is one of Mysterious Mike's favorite movies of all time. He is very passionate about sharks. He always talked about wanting to study sharks growing up in high school, which I admired, and he switched to computers. Both of us did, but he continued. I didn't. I became a photographer.
Sounds right.
So, anyways, he's still obsessed with sharks.
You're an idiot for many other reasons besides you being...
Yeah, well, that's one of the many. But that's why he's obsessed with scuba diving. He loves scuba diving.
Because he wants to get eaten by a shark.
He loves being around the sharks. He loves doing wreck dives and trying to swim with the sharks. He doesn't want to get eaten by them, but he and I got a big argument.
Good for him.
Good on him. I mean,
for not wanting to be eaten by a shark.
I would wear a suit made out of pork chops. I'd be like, come and get me. But I'm scared of the water, so no, I'm not. Anyways.
That would explain your bathing habits.
Oh, wow.
See, this podcast has gone on so long, he's getting mean now. I remember when I liked you.
No, you don't.
Yeah, you're right. I never did.
I'm surprised it took him this long.
But, no, we got an argument on what was the first original summer blockbuster. Because I argued up and down.
It was Jaws.
That it was Star Wars. Because Star Wars just set a whole nother level.
No.
He argued it's Jaws.
It was Jaws.
That's fine, but I like my wars, man.
As much as I would love to say it's Star Wars, it was Jaws. There is no question.
Oh, I know, but I still like to argue because it was just...
You just love to argue.
Bigger. Yeah.
Well, it's a different genre, too.
Yeah.
It is completely, yeah.
So
sci-fi-esque, but...
We've covered the pros and cons of going to theaters. The streaming services obviously have hurt the theater business. They have changed the way we consume stuff. There's, you know, we can go on and on about the cons of being, you know, not as impactful as seeing on the big screen. But let's talk about some of the very briefly, and then we got to wrap up because, as Matt said, it's past his bedtime.
It's past mine too.
I haven't even eaten dinner yet.
I didn't sleep last night.
The pluses of the streaming services. I'll even go back further than that. I remember when I was in high school, we got our first VHS.
We had VHS.
But I was in high school. I was in the I was out of high school, I think. Maybe it's senior year. Didn't have cable till high school. We were broadcast TV. So the advent of VHS.
Did you have Betamax?
No, did not. But a friend of ours did.
We did.
Way better quality.
Briefly.
Way better quality. And our next door neighbor owned, or three houses up, owned a Laserdisc store in town.
Oh,
those were cool. Big, yeah, big, huge. Awesome. Yeah. Anyway, so
but
the
you
the
know,
change
you know what killed Beta though, right?
And well, it was only Sony, wasn't it?
No.
Money.
No, what it always is, always, every single time when it comes
marketing.
To a hard format, nope, pornography. Whichever one pornography jumps on is the one that excels. Happened with Blu-ray, too.
Huh.
Interesting.
And DVD.
But
yeah, I know, it's messed up, but it's true.
The way we consume movies, specifically what we're talking about today, has changed. And the idea of being able to go to a store and rent a movie and watch it more than once or watch it and be able to pause it, because you couldn't do that with TV.
Right.
You couldn't do that at a theater.
Right.
Changed how we view the movie experience. Now it's on us, not on the projector.
Right.
If we need to stop it, we can hit pause. If we need to back up, we can back up. Then obviously, DVDs and Blu-rays, where the crispness, the quality changed. Things like the director's commentary and things like that.
Yep.
Oh,
completely
changed. All
the behind-the-scenes stuff.
I mean, some of these movies have more hours in behind-the-scenes stuff than the movie itself three times over.
More.
And then now, with streaming, I remember late 80s, early 90s, when you would hear reports or read an article about, there will be a time when you can turn on your TV and tell it to start playing a movie, the on-demand things were still years off. That was huge when cable and satellite TV started adding the on-demand. And now, of course, Netflix.
Stuff. Yep.
Now, of course, Netflix, Hulu, Amazon, Apple TV, everywhere else you can get stuff. Yeah, it's hurt some things. For guys like me, the beauty of it is now I can go back and watch a movie that you can't. You couldn't even find these on VHS.
Yep.
We didn't know they came out in theater because we were. You know, there's years that are blacked out for me for various reasons, but mainly for things like work. I mean, I didn't know what movies were coming out. We didn't have broadcast TV for a long time, so I didn't know what was coming out. I didn't see trailers. I don't get to the theater now. I can pull up Netflix and go, I've never heard of this movie. Well, let's watch. I've never heard of this TV show. I could watch things when I'm available at 3, 4 in the morning because I'm working all day.
And I agree with that. But on the other side, now to hurt the theaters, you have me who will say, well, that looks like it might be okay, but I'll wait until it comes out on Netflix.
But I can argue against that. Yes, the streaming services have hurt the theaters to a level, that's for sure. And as you see, and I have been a victim of it twice now, you have services like MoviePass and Cinemia where they're coming in trying to combat things like Netflix with an all-you-can-eat movie theater-going experience. And they've the two
trying
I've had
bring
has
customers
flopped.
In.
But if we had an AMC here, I would have AMC
in a bigger metro area,
or whatever it's called. My brother-in-law has it. He gets three movies a week. The AMC movie A+, whatever the hell it is exploding. And they are expanding it because people are jumping on it so big. So clearly what the problem is it needs to be tied to the theater itself, not a independent service for it to flourish. Because then the theater can say, okay, well, this isn't doing well, so we're not going to offer this. We're going to,
And the movie draw is still there. You can still get people in there. It's just it's a change in marketing now.
So it's a whole different ball game. There are pros and cons. Obviously, the convenience, the availability, the wide variety and so many choices, obviously, is just overwhelming. So there's some great things about it. I'm not going to cancel my Netflix account. I'm not going to cancel my Amazon.
No way.
There's just so much content out there, so many opportunities to enjoy stuff. we are truly living in like a golden age of entertainment. Isn't it great?
Absolutely.
Yeah, we are in a media paradise. It is it is incredible, especially for people like me that love to read, that love to look at art, that love to watch movies, that love to consume all this stuff. I don't have enough hours in the day. I really don't. I will admit that.
I'll jump to that.
Yeah. I can argue a couple. You can tell people really do love going to the movies and loving the movie theater experience just purely based on a movie that I talked about earlier. And, you know, you're arguing not going to see, you're never going to see, is Endgame.
Endgame
is lighting the world on fire. It made more domestically its first opening weekend than a movie has made since, I think, Titanic or Avatar. It's going to probably be number one. It'll probably be the first $3 billion movie. It's already made two. That blows my mind. It's literally been out for 3 weeks, and it's already made $2 billion.
Just because it makes money doesn't make it good.
No, I never said anything about
there,
it being good.
There are lots
people
of...
Well, I enjoyed it a lot. I'm not saying it's for everybody. But the experience is why people want to go.
Well, and that's the beauty of what we've been talking about for this however long we've been talking. Is there's so much so much out there that everybody can find something that appeals to them. I'm not a superhero. I'm not a sci-fi guy. There's so much more I can consume. Matt, there's so much you can watch. Dirk, there'll be more.
One of my
Star Wars TV. Is it Disney?
Yeah.
Who's continuing
Disney
Plus? That's one that's really
don't get me started.
That's a whole other podcast.
That's an interesting one that came out with. They did a poll recently, a national poll about Netflix and Disney Plus because Netflix is losing all the contracts on their Disney stuff.
Yes, yes.
That's why Disney Plus is coming. 25% of people polled said they're going to drop Netflix the instant Disney Plus comes out. So we'll see what happens with Netflix.
I will not be. I will be in the 75% that keeps it.
I'm going to keep Netflix because I like a lot of the original content. They really are signing on people that are very creative. It's great.
Oh, all right. Maddie, we got to wrap this up. Maddie,
we'll
plug away. Plug away.
Man,
where can
Real Film Nerds, it's R-E-L, not R-E-A-L. I actually bought both domains, so it doesn't matter.
Cheater.
Hinshaw Photo. Real Film Nerds, let us know how bad we are. I almost said another let us know how bad we are, because I still haven't gotten that elusive first email. So one of these days. I've gotten a handful of reviews. I got 10 reviews on iTunes. So that's
good. You've got maybe 9 more than me.
3 of them are mine.
Yeah. Dirk, where can folks find out about you and your band of pirates?
The Bluemilk Podcast.com and on Facebook, the Blue Milk Podcast.
All right. Check them out. Support these local podcasters. Support me so I can pay this bar tab. A couple of final thoughts as we go out here. One, thank you to the folks at the Raven. This is a hub, a great spot to hang out for local artists. There's original art up on the walls. They rotate it in and out. They are a great supporter of local artists, including... letting us hang out here. They've been very good to me over the years. This is one of the greatest spots for hearing and witnessing local music. So go out. That's one reason why I started this podcast in 5 years ago, was to immerse myself, get myself reacquainted with local artists, local creators of things that are great. So go out wherever you happen to be listening to this. Find, search out, go find local artists, musicians, painters, authors, whatever, podcasters, and support them. Go out there and find them and let your friends know about them. If you have a theater in your area, in your hometown, or in your surrounding area that plays older movies or specialty movies, independent films, maybe an old movie house that's a single screen, support it. Tell others. Share it on social media. We can never, in this world of streaming and of on-demand and of personalized entertainment, nothing will take the place of walking into a theater, turning off your cell phone, and sitting with your family watching the big screen stuffing your face with popcorn. Go out and enjoy that. And I shouldn't have to say this, but I will because I'm sure it rings true. There are some of you listening to this who may have never seen a movie in a theater.
Do it.
Do it. You know, go find a local playhouse that does live entertainment. Support local comedy. Come to the Raven the third Thursday of every month, and listen to some jokes. Do something.
Listen to Mr. Mile High Show tell jokes about me for a half hour.
Do something that creates art, that encourages those people that are creating art. Go out and create some of your own.
Thank you for listening to The Real Film Nerds. Now, don't forget to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Real Film Nerds. Now, go out and catch a movie.